I broadcasted now.
And governments being what they are and elections coming up, I felt it necessary to have a special meeting so we could discuss our options and move forward with some decisions before we have yet another governing body come January 1, where, as past history has shown, we seem to reboot and start the process over, which is a disservice to both the members of the DPW, the employees of the DPW, our employees at the Borough Hall, and to the taxpayer at large. So that said, I hope we can get some things accomplished this evening. And I will now turn this over to Teresa Casagran, where she can lead us through with our borough engineer and our borough architect. Teresa?
Excuse me, Mayor. Mayor, can I say something first, please?
Yes,
thank you. I just want to address my fellow council members first. As council president, I'd like to remind everybody that we've been elected to make informed and sometimes rather tough decisions. Some of you are new, some of you have been on for a while, and we've had to make some tough decisions over the years. We've been, as the mayor stated, been working on this project for over 5 years. We have listened to the residents, we have listened to the professionals, we have listened to our borough staff. We need to mitigate all the negatives and accentuate the positives. None of us are going to be completely happy with what we finally come up with, but we need to come together as a governing body, and I'm asking us all to please come together as a governing body and move this process along and forward. The residents of this town elected us to do just that, make these decisions. More importantly, we owe it to, the residents of the town owe us to that elected us. And more importantly, those that work for the borough deserve better and safer facilities than they are currently working within. I am pleased, very pleased, that the newest members of council made a commitment at the beginning of the year to get up to speed on the facilities projects. And so that we are now at the stage where we can truly come together, because we do have an obligation to work together and make decisions. And that's why Betsy and I requested this meeting. And I'm hoping that we can really make some tough decisions, whether it's tonight or at a meeting that is very soon after this. So that's all I wanted to say, Mayor. Chris and I have been on this forever. So I've been on it, I think, the longest. So
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Council President Sorensen. Sorry, I jumped ahead. All right.
I will take it briefly from here, Mayor. I'm going to, not reiterate anything of what the mayor opened with or with the Council President Sorensen said. I will say, when we started this process 5 long years ago, we had said more than once the path of least resistance was to repair the current facilities in their current locations, but that has not been deemed the best path forward by any number of councils that have sat for the last 5 years. What we'd like to do this evening is to separate the DPW project from the PD project. I think it's fair to say that we'll go first with the DPW project. We have a lot more time and effort and energy and planning invested in that project. As you well know, for many reasons, and we can elaborate on our thought process and how we got there, the design plan that has been contemplated for DPW up to this date has been, and released to the public, has been for the building to be moved towards 3rd Street and the rest of the DPW site. And it's worth noting that site work at DPW is the majority of the project, would be behind that and shielded from the public as much as possible. Your professionals are here tonight. Rich Gardella knows his site as good as anyone, and he's going to take the site engineering piece of this for Eli, as opposed to Eli's professional. And Eli Goldstein has done a significant amount of work. I think it's important to realize, when you look at this DPW site, when you talk about it, you consider what's been done already to this point in preparation and in testing and everything that went into where we are right now. So I'm going to turn it over to Eli to just give you the general parameters of where he is in this process of DPW. And then if we want to talk about the building location, he can flip-flop back and forth between Rich and Eli, and I will stay silent unless I'm asked a question.
I just want to make a statement that I actually believe that the police department is the priority, followed by DPW, followed by the community center. I understand why you're going with the DPW because the plans are more baked, but I do think that the police department is a higher priority.
Thank you, Chris.
So just bear with me a second as I get this up on the screen.
And the, those of you who are listening, Eli is very soft-spoken, so please bear with him.
Thank you, Mayor. Just bear with me 1 second. Actually, I think it would be helpful if Rich could give a little bit of a description of the site, and then I'll bring up the site plan.
Let's do that. And that's most more important than anything, because I think that's what's really here to be discussed. So, Rich, yeah. Can you bring up the site plan?
Yeah, hold on. I'll bring up the current survey. Give me 2 seconds.
I can bring up the rendered site plan if that would be helpful, Rich.
Let's show them the pretty picture, I guess, first, if you can, real quick.
Here's the rendered site plan. Everybody see that okay?
Yes.
Okay, so Rich, you want to walk them
sure. through this? Okay, so this is a portion of the existing DPW site. This plan utilizes the northerly portion. Down here is 3rd Street. On the right is Allen, and then on the left is Maple. The existing building is slightly overlaps that green area where that pointer is. So basically what this does is shrink the existing site to this footprint while retaining recycling area, storage for, you know, our equipment, vehicles, salt storage, obviously the salt dome, parking for both employees and visitors, and then the building as it's situated on this property being proposed along 3rd Street. In addition, utilizing some screening and buffering along the perimeter of the site, maintaining a green space in front of the building as it sits on 3rd, and also providing those numbered spaces to allow for overflow parking during off hours for utilization by the community center fields, which is directly across and adjacent right on 3rd Street. So basically this is, I think, Eli, correct me if I'm wrong, we've gone through some design internally with your engineer, trying to maximize the efficiency of the space, circulation of the space. I think we've been through a couple dozen versions working yes. with my department, you know, based on our needs and requests and our current, you know, day-to-day operations.
Right.
So that's pretty much it as it relates to the site with this version.
Okay, so let me take a moment, Mayor, if it's okay with you.
Yes.
Talk about the building.
Yes, please do, Eli.
Okay, so this is the current plan of the building. And it's 3rd Street would be down here. Basically, it consists of 3 pods, basically. The middle is for the large equipment. The left side, the east side, is for the smaller vehicles. And the west end is the workroom and the offices and the staff bathrooms. And there's a stair here that leads to an attic or a mezzanine over the largest pieces of equipment for use for sign making and other activities that need some floor space free of the equipment. And then, excuse me, this is the proposed view from the parking lot of the DPW. These are the doors for the largest vehicles, the doors for the smaller vehicles. And this again is the office wing. This then would be the north elevation, the view from 3rd Street. And here in cross section, you can see it's basically a one-story building with the small mezzanine here above the largest pieces of equipment. The building has been articulated and broken down into smaller masses in order to be more compatible with the scale of the houses in the surrounding neighborhood, as well as having a material on the siding and the shingle roofing to make it look like it belongs in that neighborhood rather than use an industrial metal building, which is common for public works garages. So Mayor, that's the overview.
That's it. All right. Is there anything else you want to add, Rich, as far as the functioning of the site, location of the areas in the site plan?
The only thing I have to add is when we went into this project, we wanted to kind of take it from like a less is more approach. Mm-hmm. And the building design is one thing, and the site itself needs to work kind of on its own, because from a DPW day-to-day operation, the employees are basically coming and going to the site. They need to have the proper access in and out of the site, the circulation within the site, be able to, get to the equipment, provide maintenance, whatever we're doing, and then go back out and perform the tasks at hand. The building is somewhat secondary. Obviously, it's got a mechanic piece of it. It's got storage. It's got offices, things of that nature. But the site itself, from a DPW yard, and then also incorporating, obviously, maintaining the existing recycling center, which is heavily utilized by our residents, putting that in an appropriate location so it can be accessed both during business hours and, as you know, off hours. And then obviously during storm-related times when we have to come in at night to do snow plowing operations, or we just had that tropical storm and we're working, Saturdays and Sundays, we need to be able to, function and get into the site and keep going. The other thing we can also show is, obviously, we've got this one plan that shows the building at 3rd. I did a quick sketch, which I can share my screen, which shows the building at the southerly area.
Mm-hmm.
Let me pull that up.
And for the general public who are joining us, I'll say this: when we originally began this 5 years ago, part of the concept was to right size the facility and shrink it, in essence, reducing the industrial use within the residential zone. The other concept we had at the time was to perhaps make enough room so we could have say different housing stock or whatever on the back of the property, or have some more vacant land for future borough administrations to do something with. So that was the initial idea, perhaps sell that land off for housing to help to fray the costs. But as we've gone into the project, we've stepped away from that with the sole purpose of just looking at the facility and how to do, basically deliver a new facility at the best possible cost, leaving the residential component aside.
Mayor, if I can also add, I know, if I recall, Rich worked very closely with Eli as to what were the necessities that are needed for this facility, and what, how many parking spaces were needed, enough room for the public to park,
et cetera, et cetera. And really right-sized is, I guess, the term, right-sized the facility, but didn't, along with, you know, making sure that we had everything that was needed to function as a DPW. And so there was a lot of work that went into it from, you know, from Rich's perspective with Eli to make sure that we really had everything. And this is what, 4 years ago, 3 years ago that all took place, regardless of where anything's located on the site.
Yep. All right, Rich, this is the...
This is the most recent site plan that we worked with Eli's group and his engineer. It shows a little bit of additional parking here on Allen. So you've got up to 15 spaces. It also incorporates the OEM shed, you know, for their storage of equipment, et cetera. And then the impound yard for the PD. So we added that. And obviously the internal workings, you know, the parking spaces, the salt dome, the fueling station, and then the building as it sits on Third. So this is more of an updated version of the rendering that was up a few moments ago. This other plan is just a quick sketch I overlaid. So this existing gray area is the asphalt as it currently exists within the site. This is the building here that kind of backs up to Maple that we currently work out of. This particular plan would push the building to the south, basically overlapping where the existing recycling yard is and into the woods slightly, but then also maintaining, you know, a wooded buffer between the building and the properties that are on Maple and Hendrickson. And then basically the size of the lot to be utilized in this concept would be similar in nature to what this would be. So whatever this area is, we would just kind of flip-flop it to the south, and then the property remaining, this is another scheme that we had looked at, which would allow for the potential of, you know, three residential lots along Third.
So then you Rich, is that yeah. little box right behind the three houses, is that where like general parking, I mean, or public parking could be for sporting events?
This is a little trickier because obviously now you're pushing it more into the residential neighborhood. So you'd have to incorporate a parking lot and somehow provide a safe access to get back to Third Street and then across to the fields.
Right.
This is about 110, 120 feet in.
Okay.
So where the other one, as you can see, is pretty much directly adjacent. And the way this is designed, this is sort of like a fence line. So this will be secured during off hours, and then this parking lot would be able to be open, you know, in the evenings and weekends as necessary.
Mayor, how do you want to go around and provide opportunities for folks to chime in an orderly manner?
Well, I think Susan Sorensen just spoke, so I was going to go on to you next, but I'd say the key elements here are, or differences, is that the secondary plan with the building flip to the south does allow for three or five lots, is it, Rich?
Three lots. Just fronting on Third.
Yep. And then, you know, kind of having the housing consistent with the other housing on Third, and then the DPW being pushed back into the existing woods. The main difference is you do lose the parking, you know, the weekend parking for community center fields. That's one or the other. You know, what I'm trying to do is get down to a binary decision here. We'll go from there. So see, Susan has spoken. So Chris, let's go with you next.
Sure.
You're the head of facilities.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to make one quick comment that we'll talk about the community center shortly. But my suggestion when it comes to parking will be accommodated with the community center and police department location. as opposed to utilizing anything with the DPW. But as far as the DPW building is concerned, I think it's appropriate to have a single floor, multi-bay facility building with offices and locker rooms and the ability to do all the mechanical work and storage necessary. Personally, I prefer the southern end of the site directly adjacent to the current building. So if you can imagine just pivoting the building on its southern point so that it just sits perpendicular to the current building. There's a couple of reasons why I believe this is the best scenario. It allows us to maintain use of the current building while we build the new building. It allows us to maintain the frontage on Third Street. If we elect to do something in terms of residential there, we can. It also maintains the current site plan without moving the building to that grassy area on Third. So the vehicle flow, the parking, and the use of the site remain substantially similar to what the residents are currently used to. I would prefer to not move the salt dome, not move the gas pump, and allow the vehicle flow to happen similar or the same that it currently does. My preference is to have a 40-year useful life on the building and make sure that the councils and mayors and in the future understand what our intentions were, what kind of maintenance of the building and the site would be necessary, and when, you know, when it needs to be planned for in terms of replacing that building in the future from a financing perspective and from a maintenance perspective. This, again, I mentioned was my second highest priority, second to the police department, which I'm sure we'll get to shortly, which is where I would propose any additional parking for the ball fields and for the community center to be rather than at the DPW site. I yield the rest of my time back to you, Mayor.
There we go. Let's go to Council. Let's see, Mike McHugh, you're also on the Facilities Committee.
Thanks, Mayor. Rich, when for the proposed building on the north side, how many lots, if any, are available for future housing redevelopment?
So the space that would be left would be up here, basically from this 10-foot wide landscape buffer that we show to the south. I think we laid out, give or take, five or six.
Okay.
Just because the property has this interesting jog in the back here, so we'd have to see how that lot line is adjusted and how it lays out, assuming it's R5 designation.
Right. I think I see it's a blue line.
Yes. Basically here, comes along here, down this way, and then down Allen, back around.
Right. So we would have more possible available lots to sell, but we're getting up into the number, that magic number of five, I believe, where that might affect our fair share housing. Is that correct? If anyone else wants to chime in and inform me.
I think if it's not really a matter of relevance right now, the fair share housing, you know, according to our professionals, it's not something they want to, you know, get into. It would depend on the size of the lots and whether or not the borough ever developed them. It's too far down the road to even speculate on.
Okay. So kind of at first glance, we would almost have double the amounts, mm-hmm. double the amount of lots if we were on the north side. Also, I think I know the answer to this, but I just want to get it on the record. If we go to the building on the south side, we need to do additional tests, right? Borings and stuff like that.
Yeah, we already, with anticipation of putting the building down on Third, our soils engineers already came and did extensive soil borings and analysis. And they would have to then basically start over and not only in order to perform it up here, they're going to have to maybe clear cut some of this to get into the woods so they can get the drill rig in there and do the borings.
Because of where the building
would be situated.
So just two follow-up questions. Was the soil okay to build on? What were the results of the north side proposal building for the soil?
Eli, you want to answer that or?
Yeah, the soil was okay. The conditions were not completely consistent from one corner of the building to the other. So it was going to require some removal and replacement and compaction. But it wasn't terrible.
Okay. My follow-up question. What's the cost estimate on more tests on the south side to run those tests?
I don't remember offhand.
Think we spent about $10,000 on the soil testing, if I'm not mistaken.
That sounds about right. Yeah.
Final thing, I'll just express an opinion. I personally like that open parking lot, Rich, where with the enclosed area, the bottom right-hand corner that could be utilized for baseball games and whatnot at the community ball fields. Would we be able to get that kind of parking lot available to the public if we move the public works building on the south side?
The parking lot would have to be incorporated up in this area somewhere, which is kind of in the middle of the neighborhood where this pulls it down to the intersection. And then also, as you can see, we've even utilized putting 7 on-street parking spaces here in front of the new building. So you're going to pick up a 15 plus the 7.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that is consistent with the existing sidewalks, that north side parking. We wouldn't have to move any of those sidewalks.
Yeah. When we put in the new sidewalk on 3rd, we pushed it back enough to allow the widening of 3rd Street for this on-street parking and to line up the new curb line with the adjacent block. So then it would be a consistent design and width on 3rd Street.
All right, looks great. That's it for now, thank you. Thank you, Mayor. Thanks, Rich.
Thanks.
Ben, you're on mute.
James Banahan next. Jim?
I'm here. I think I've been consistent from the first time I took a look at this plan. I'm in favor of moving the new building to the south side of the lot and retaining the frontage on 3rd Street for a potential future sale as R5s. If we look at what happens once the building is pushed out to 3rd Street, you're now affecting more homes than are affected right now in terms of a downgrade in value by the presence of the DPW building. If we move it to the south side, it has no more impact than it does now. And it's actually less visible than moving the building to 3rd Street. I don't know if anyone has seen the Photoshop that was done by someone about what the building looks like on 3rd Street. In as much as it's got pitched roofs and there's 3 elements to it, almost looks a little bit like a church or a meeting hall. It's a little bit outsized. So I'm in favor of moving the new building to the south side of the lot and retaining the frontage on 3rd Street for potential future sale as residences. I think it's more in keeping with the nature of 3rd Street, especially since it's something of a sacred roadway for us, closed for the kids, et cetera. It's where transition day happens. I just don't think there's anything good from putting the buildings out to the front on 3rd.
Okay, thank you, Jim. And sure. Betsy Koch, the head of planning and zoning, I'll let you have the last word for this round.
I do have a question for Eli. If we were to move the DPW to the southern end of the property, You talked about there needed to be some remediation for the soil, some compaction, maybe bringing in some more soil. If we were to create three residential lots in that area, would we still need to remediate the soil?
The answer to that question is not one I'm equipped to give you. I suspect probably not, because residences are less, they weigh a lot less than a building full of big pieces of construction and maintenance equipment. So I suspect probably not, or if any remediation would be required, it would probably be less. But of course, what we don't know is what we're going to find when we test the soil at the south end. And right. So,
And I want to verify there is some remediation that work that has to be done that's related to the site and the piece over by third anyway, based on testing we have done and work we're doing with the DEP for some cleanup work that's done on the, that needs to be done on the site.
Very minor.
Okay, so Eli, I have another question for you. In your introduction, you mentioned that the building that you created that would go on the northern end of the property was probably a little bit more expensive because of the way you designed it to fit in with the neighborhood. Is that what you, did I hear you correctly?
Yeah, that's correct, yeah.
Okay, so I have, like Jim, been in favor of moving the building to the southern end of the property for quite a few reasons. One is, I think 3rd Street has turned out to be an incredibly beautiful residential area. And I think by putting the Public Works building in that vicinity kind of downgrades the neighborhood. I think putting three homes and all the homes that are being built on 3rd Street right now are beautiful, really will help to maintain the residential character of 3rd Street. So my I was king, my first thing would be to move the building to the southern end of the property, recognizing that we still have to do soil testing. But by moving the building back there, we've created three lots. I think originally there were 9 lots that were suggested on the property if we kept the building at the northern end. I think that still allows us to create 4 or 5 lots. So we're back around 8. And I think it gives us the option to create a building that might be a little bit less expensive than if we had it on 3rd Street. So if I had to vote, I would vote to move it the building on the southern end. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just realized I passed over Councilperson Christner Keefe. Meg, would you like to chime in now?
Sure, yes. Thank you, Ben. Eli or Rich, I'm not sure who's controlling the photos. Can you just flop back to the building on the southern side of the property? Okay. Would this setup change the curb cuts, entry, and exits to the facility?
Yes, the curb, the existing curb cut is right here where my pointer is. Okay. It would be too close to this building. It would probably have to be shifted down. We haven't really laid it out to see the inner workings. The purpose of this was just to show a concept of the building in general, kind of pushed into the woods there.
Okay, and aside from the DPW building and a potential future consideration of 3 residential properties on 3rd Street.
Right.
Is there anything else that is known or knowable about the setup with the building on the south side?
Well, we would probably look at this plan that was put together showing it on the north end and flip the building up and then see how all this stuff falls into place. I suspect we're gonna have to slide just about everything around to make it work. Because this public parking lot is going to change in configuration, and then all the accessory uses within the site, which is the impound yard, the OEM shed, salt dome, the fueling station, and then obviously the parking for the vehicles. So that we would have to do a redesign and see how it all lays out.
I could just interject for a second. One of the council members mentioned trying to keep the building, if it's on the south, very close to the footprint of the existing building. So Rich, if you pull it up, we will need to maintain some distance between them for construction purposes and also for fire purposes, because you need to maintain at least 20 feet or so during construction between an existing building and a new one for fire protection purposes.
But the just the point I was making is that we could keep the salt dome where it is, we can keep the gas pump where it is, we can keep a significant amount of the pavement intact without having to reorient the entire site. That was part of my proposal.
Yeah, and that was my question. Thank you, Chris. That was my question, just to see if there were any cost, if there's, you know, a cost-benefit analysis of one setup over the other. And I guess one of my additional questions would be whether or not there was any consideration, whether historically or never, to rebuild the building in its current location. I understand, obviously, that presents challenges from the perspective of tearing it down, having nothing to work in, and then having to put it back up. But that aside, was that a consideration?
It's one of the considerations we've talked about over the years, but for various reasons, including what you just stated, for the functionality of the site, taking the building down from a construction standpoint did not make sense. We also would have to retest the soil underneath that building, even though there's a building on it, and Eli can jump in here and rescue me. But I do recall a topic coming up that we had to, we just couldn't assume we could build a new building there without testing the soils. Correct, Eli?
That's correct. And the building, and the current building has a lot of very serious problems. So I think it's fair to say it's not really a matter of renovation so much as complete replacement on the same site. And as Teresa mentioned, that has implications in terms of where the public works people are going to work out of for the next, or for however long it takes to do it.
We also started this thinking we needed to hold on to the salt dome and the fuel pumps, but the salt dome is almost 16 years old and they have about a 20-year life expectancy. So designing around a salt dome that's, by the time you're done, 2 years from life expectancy, I'm not saying we couldn't keep it in the same spot, but there's no point in trying to hold on to it as a linchpin for this plan. As far as the fuel pumps go, they too will need to be replaced. We've tried to have them repaired and the panels upgraded so we can, you know, monitor fuel and everything, but the fuel pumps are too old for that. To be able to do that.
Thank you. And I guess my final question, again, might not be known or determined as of yet. If I understand correctly, positioning the building on the north side would include on-street parking, some additional spots of on-street parking. Would that be also true of locating the building on the south side?
I don't believe so, because... Well, for one, this is unknown what we're doing down here. The purpose of the on-street parking would allow for visitors. You know, we have the public, vendors, deliveries, et cetera, people coming and going all day. That would allow some overflow parking there. These parking stalls would be actually utilized by our employees, the 15 here. And then obviously have some extra for visitors, et cetera. But with the building, if we push the building all the way to the south, as I had shown here, I don't anticipate putting, and Eli, correct me if wrong, I don't think we anticipate putting any on street on third.
Correct.
You know, where these are actually, we're actually showing striped stalls, you know, to keep it uniform in nature. Right.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Hey, Ben, this is Mayor, this is Susan. I didn't know that I was allowed to just ask one question and I was done. So I actually have a bunch of questions. I was just asking one thing about that.
Certainly.
So I'm not married to the building being on the north side or the south side. Both have its merits. My only question is if we do move the building to the, I keep getting them mixed up. The side that's near the woods, that's south. The south side, south side, yeah. Would there be an ability to maybe carve out, instead of leaving room for three buildings or three homes across Third Street, maybe making one a small parking lot? You know, a community lot or something like that. Any consideration? I mean, I know that's giving up some very valuable real estate, but there is a need for additional parking there during on the weekends for games. I mean, it's not a deal breaker by any means, but it's just something that I know that a lot of residents have requested over the years. So that's just something I'm throwing out there. And then one other question, and that is, by moving the building to the south side, would we be able to shrink the lot, you think, Rich, a little bit, as well as, because I know, if I remember correctly, it was like $1.7 or $1.9 million for just the land, you know, not the facility itself, but just the property.
The site work.
And what we needed to do, what'd you say?
The site work.
Site work, thank you. To, you know, the site work was like, was it 1.7 or 1.9? It was something like that. If there's a way to bring, because I think we were all a little ticker, you know, shocked by the cost of that when that came in. And if there was a way to make even that ever so less by moving the building to the south side, I would definitely be in favor of that. Because if I know we have to replace the gas tank. I know the dome, we should never build around that anyway, but and it's near its end of life. But if there's any way that we can make it smaller and save some money, I'm totally in favor of that. So just, do we know, Rich, if we could make the property of the site work smaller? Or Eli, either one?
I think we've already got, we've shrunk this as much as we can. And Eli's professionals have done a great job to try to incorporate everything that we currently do while also bringing in the OEM shed and maintaining the existing impound yard for PD.
Okay.
So
even the pub, what would be on the weekends, a public parking lot, we would still need, but might not be able to allow it to be open to the public. We would still need those spots for that, for our employees and.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, the spots on the interior, you can see most of them are labeled based on the equipment we have, you know, trucks, yeah, and motors and packers and trailers, etc. The answer to your question is we would still have to utilize this footprint, kind of flip-flop it and redesign it to make it work for the building. Because the garage bays would now be facing out towards Third, and then we'd have to see how access off Allen is maintained, you know, in and out, and then basically put everything you see here into that, you know, push it up to the south.
Okay.
So your costs are probably going to be about the same.
All right. Well, maybe the soil's a little better and we'll save a little money on this if we put it on the south side versus the north side. Fingers crossed. All right, Mayor, that's it from my perspective. Thank you.
All right. So it seems the tenor of the council is to come up with yet another site plan, locating the building to the south so we can examine what impacts that may have. And then the other element that Councilman Chris Rodriguez is like is change the access from the building from being north-south to being east-west. I think at the end of the day, it's we will be impacting residences no matter what we do. And it's just a question whose ox we're going to gore. Be that as it may, with the consensus of the council, we will ask Rich and Eli to put their heads together and come up with basically a binary or three different plans for us to vote on, hopefully at our next meeting. One is the existing plan we see right now with the building to the north, another one with the building to the south facing the north, and another one with the building to the south facing west on the site next to it, if that's possible, and see how that works out. I'd like to now move on to a discussion.
Mayor, this is Teresa. I just want to clarify one thing. The site work design will be done by Eli's site engineer. Yes. Rich is in the middle of multiple other projects, as you know, for the borough, and he has not done the majority of the site work. The only thing we asked Rich to do was lay the building in yes. after the last meeting, but it'll be Eli and his site engineer that actually do the layout you just asked for.
Yes. Excuse me. I understand that. All right. So let's move on to the police station, have that discussion, and then we'll open it up to the public.
And Mayor, I apologize. I just have one more comment, and that is I thought that Betsy Koch, Councilman Koch, brought up an excellent point, and that is that if we do have the facility not facing 3rd Street, that the building doesn't necessarily have to have all the beautiful bells and whistles that we had designed on the outside to make it look like it landscapes. So I'd like to see some options from Eli when he comes back regarding that, like downgrading some of that to save the borough some money. I know the inside is not going to change. I just mean some of the beautification that we had on the outside.
You want to wait on the soil boring testing until you decide which layout you're looking at?
Yes, I believe it's probably prudent to do that. Let's see if we can get it down to a design we can all agree on, or at least get three people to agree on, and then we can move forward.
Do we need three plans, or can we just do the south and the existing?
I agree, Chris.
Chris, in order to accommodate your request, we're going to have to do three separate layouts, which are very expensive to do.
Yeah, no, I'm only proposing a south version, one south version, and the existing version is what I was suggesting.
Okay, but you know, the question is, do you want the building oriented, facing with the garage doors facing north, or do you want, you know, I thought what you were advocating for is having the garage doors oriented to the west.
No, I apologize if I miscommunicated. If we pivot the building on its corner and orient it to a south, an east-west orientation along the south edge of the existing site, mm-hmm. where the bays empty into the current parking lot, mm-hmm. Which they would be facing north at that point, the bays. That yes. was all I was suggesting. That's all.
Okay. I misunderstood you then.
Alrighty. I think that's a good idea, because we already have a site plan for the building on the northern end of the property. I would think we only need one site plan for the moving the building to the south end of the property.
That was my proposal.
Yeah, it's still going to change everything, Betsy. That building was designed with the garage doors in the rear. The garage doors will have to be in the front facing third.
Right. So that would be the difference. But what I'm saying is, and I think what Councilman Rodriguez is saying, we already have the initial site plan for the property at the northern yeah. end. So we don't need to redo that. We don't need to do.
We just need to do one more.
We don't need three plans. We only need to create one new one is okay. what we're all saying.
Correct.
Yeah, one new one. I misunderstood what Chris was describing. I thought he wanted the garage doors oriented to the west. So that'll be it. So it'll be two site plans to choose from.
And what about soil borings? Do you want to take soil borings in the south as part of this in order to be able to talk about the costs that are associated with it? Or do you want to wait until the selection of the site?
I don't know. I think how much is it, Teresa?
I believe it was around $10,000 for the whole process, if I'm not mistaken.
I mean, I'd hate for us to make a decision and then come back and it's a nightmare.
Well, relative, the other thing is you have to clear cut the woods in order to get the rig back there.
Oh, okay.
Relative to the cost of the entire project, $10,000 is like one basis point or 10 basis points, not even a percentage point of the project. So
in our current budget, already has, I think, a number of about $250,000 for unsuitable soils. So it probably shouldn't be much different from that.
Am I remembering correctly that the placing the building on the north end required replacing soil on that part of the site anyway?
Yes.
Partially with some compaction.
All right. So if that's the case, then there is a good possibility. It's a little bit of a roll of the dice, but there's a good possibility we'll find better soil on the south end. And then that's an expense that's removed, and it'll more than make up for the $10,000 in the boring cost.
Okay, I'm confused. Are we saying that we want to go in and clear cut a portion of the woods right now so we can perform the soil boring test prior to agreeing on the site layout? Or were you willing to wait until we agree on how we're laying out the site to go in and look, examine the constructability of the facility?
All right, maybe somebody jump in and stop me if I'm wrong, but there's no point in redesigning to put the building on the south end if it's gonna be the same situation where we're gonna have to have a major expense for replacing soil, trucking it out and trucking in soil. So we might as well do the soil boring first.
I would agree with that.
Well, I do have a question. Well, to Ben's point, we already know what it's gonna cost us on the front end. It couldn't be worse, right? Or could it? We already know. If I remember, that was like a lot of money. That to do. I want to say, Teresa, do you have that? Was it like $400,000 or something like that of the expense? Something like that. I could be wrong, but
that's so, I mean, the number.
Everybody,
we already know that.
I tell you what. How about if we just let the professionals come up with that analysis, and we can send out a memo later on, discuss it. I don't want to spend the whole night with people who have never developed anything in their lives debating really what are pedestrian issues here. Okay. I apologize. Let's move on.
So you're shutting us up?
Well, no.
All of us to spitball and try to come up with a solution. Yeah,
I understand. Okay. But
Eli, I think your engineer and I and yourself, we can do a layout, and I would hold off on the soil borings.
Yeah. Thank you, Rich.
I would. Because you're going to have to get in there, clear cut some of that woods, bring the rig in. We can assume worst case scenario, but I think the purpose of the plan is to see how it lays out with the building to the south.
And yeah, just to clarify.
That was exactly what I was trying to say, Ben.
There was a lot of money for soil removal. But a lot of it had nothing to do with the footprint of the building. It had to do with soil issues elsewhere on the site.
And we don't even know if we can get the soil boring guy scheduled in a timely manner.
That's true.
You know, before the next meeting.
So as I said before, let's see if we can come up with a design we can agree on, and then we'll examine the constructability. Okay.
Agreed.
Let's move on to the police station. Eli, I believe you have some sketches of what a police facility may look like.
Only just very diagrammatic for preliminary discussion purposes. So let me pull that up. Okay, so here's where we were before. Okay, so here is a sort of rendered Google Earth image. This is the existing police and court, police and community center building. This is the basketball court. Here is Fisk Street. North in this plan is up. Here is the church. This is the existing parking lot, the existing paved area. Again, here is Fisk. And these are houses across the street. Everyone can see that, all right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is one possibility, which I had discussed, when we just talked about this last month, where, for example, you could build a new building somewhere in the middle of the width of the police site. This assumes that in this scenario, you try to stay within the boundaries of the existing site and not cross into the area where the recreational facilities are and not cross into any of the neighboring property. And the only reason, the main reason why, we had suggested two separate parking lots because this building is going to have two very different uses. It's going to contain the police department and all of the vehicles that go with it. It's also going to be serving the public, either visitors to the police department and or visitors to whatever the other function or functions are on the site, whether it's a community center or municipal offices. So we were trying to separate the parking somewhat because it's not particularly desirable to have the public moving parking intermingled with police vehicles that may have to leave on fairly short notice. Now, in this particular scenario, one of the issues is that this footprint overlaps the existing building a little bit. So in order to build the building in this location, you would have to take down the existing police building first. And if you try to keep the existing building and build the new one while the existing building is still intact, it severely limits the layouts of the site. We recognize the importance of trying to do that because of the cost that will be involved if the police have to move out for a year and a half. And we're doing a number of other police buildings in New Jersey currently where we're building next to an existing building, which will be demolished later. But normally we have more room. There's really not much room here to do that. And so while we can do it, and we will do it if that's the will of the council, another possibility would be to find a place to offload some of the parking to give you a little more freedom to lay out the site. And so that's another scenario that can be considered. So let me just go one more slide here. So this is a very rough blocking showing the view down Fisk Street. This is where the church is. This is very rough block of the existing police building and community center. And you can see that they're fairly close to one another, which I'm sure you all are aware of. And then if you build the new building more toward the middle of the site, you can see right there, it moves away from the church. And this is meant to suggest the building will be this shape. It's just an approximate volume for a building of about 5,000 square feet per floor, which is the order of magnitude that we've been talking about. So I hope that's helpful for people to visualize. We're not proposing any particular character to the building at this time, but we wanted you to be aware of some of the site constraints that are shown here.
Understood. Eli, if we were to go with the plan where we site the building in the middle of the property, when the building's completed, how many parking spaces will we have, and will we need to encroach on our neighbors or seek other additional parking facilities?
So this is the sketch that I had developed about a month ago, and this has Fisk on the bottom, so we're flipped around. So the church is over here. The church is on this side.
So the church would be on the left-hand side of the sketch, right in there, yes.
And then this would be public. So you have about 15 spaces for the public and about 15 spaces for the police official vehicles and perhaps some staff vehicles. And just so everyone understands, one of the aspects of the police building which complicates this is that it's going to require a sally port, an enclosed garage. And so another reason to split these areas is to keep the public here, because there's going to be movement in and out of a garage, whether it's on the side or in the front or in the back. We've got to make room for it somewhere.
Great. Rich, do you know offhand how many parking spaces we have at the current facility? I'm kind of put you on the spot, but
I could look it up for you real quick if you want.
But right now we're looking at about, so this new facility, which is the police station and community center, new facility is showing about 30 parking spaces. And then I imagine all the land to the back where the basketball court walk to rec facilities. Teresa, that's the limit of the property, or are we allowed to develop that, or is that that's on the Rossi. So the building
blue basketball court included.
Okay, so that's as far as we can go.
Right. So in answer to your question, Mayor, this is the property line on the west. This is the property line on the east. We're keeping away from the recreational areas, and we're keeping away from the church. This leaves the development completely within that enclosure. And you can see in dotted lines here, this is the footprint of the existing building, and that's where the overlap is.
All right.
Ben, you're probably looking at maybe 25 to 28 spaces existing.
Existing and with 30 proposed.
Yeah, and Mayor, if I could say something here.
Yes, Chief.
Yeah, I would say if the footprint of the parking lot looks like it's about where it is now, so the only thing you're really losing right now would be those very back spots, because if he's using the same size per space and it's going to go all the way to the back where the basketball courts are, it should be the same. And then you're going to be adding these few that you show in the front. Eli, could you go back to that slide, the first one you showed of the when you first came on? Next one, please. One right, more. Here. Maybe yeah, one.
That's one the existing.
More. Yeah,
the
one proposed. More. Yeah, proposed. Next one.
Yeah.
Eli, would it fit if we took that building, looking at the screen, and moved it to the left and moved it up closer to the street, and then you could put police parking behind it, and then the other side could all be public, or that would not work?
We can look at that. We just have to make sure that, let's go back to the sketch for a second. We just have to make sure there's enough room to get around. We need a drive aisle of at least 24 feet in here.
Okay.
So it's going to come down to inches. As you can see, everything here is very, very tight. It's extremely tight because of we only have 150 feet to work with.
Mm-hmm.
But we can certainly look at that. This is not meant to be, you know, the only choice. We just wanted to show you one way of fitting it here.
Okay. Very good. Let's start the discussion here. And
Mayor, before you discuss, I want to mention one thing for the benefit of the council and the public. Our current generator at the police and community center, which is a key generator for the borough, because we also use that for our public cooling and access station during storms where we lose power, is no longer serviceable. It broke down right before the last big storm, and we had, it's about, how old, Joe, 25 years old, that generator?
Yeah, yeah, 25 years old, correct.
About 25 years old, and it just, it cannot be replaced, repaired. So currently we are renting a generator that's temporarily set up in the police department in the parking lot area. If you drive by, it's not an inexpensive rental. And it's mounting by the week. We have it on a lower rate now because it's not active, but it is being rented by the week for the site. Once it's active, it's even more expensive. So the initial thought was that we would work with Eli and purchase a diesel generator that we could bring in to the site and hook it up to, you know, where the current temporary generator is, bring another one into the site and hook it up to the panel as the rented generator is doing now, and kind of reuse that same generator in the construction. I don't know how that'll work if we end up having to take the police department building down, and that's just another piece of this. I'd like to get some consensus of the council to move forward with the purchase of a generator for that building sooner rather than later, because at least that can come out of capital as opposed to our current fund budget where the rented generator is currently coming out.
So Eli has sized the appropriate generator in the fact that it's a standby for an essential facility. It can't be natural gas, it has to be diesel. And we have the appropriate size. I think when we get to the point, you know, we purchased a generator, we can have it operating hopefully fairly quickly, a couple of months. And then the police facility will be have a steady state of power. When it comes time to demolish the building, we could relocate the generator to another area, perhaps use that to back up the power for the police station, which will be probably in trailers at that point, which is a common practice in New Jersey when you rebuild police facilities. I know it's not the best condition for our police officers, but certainly better than the current facility. And then when the new facility is constructed, we can then move the generator back. You know, doing that many moves isn't the best thing in the world, but then again, it helps us with our mission critical status of the facility. So to the council, I think we should approve, perhaps not tonight, but Teresa put the package together for the acquisition of the generator and put it on the next meeting's agenda so we can vote on that. And I believe that would be the best course of action going forward. The other debate that I think we should have with this facility, and what we're looking at is probably our best case scenario with setting up the site with the police building facility in the middle, is conceptually this building is going to be at three levels. There'll be a basement level, which will serve as the server room for the borough, record storage for the borough, and then also a cooling center. You know, because it is 5,000 square feet, there'll be a fairly substantial room. The 5,000 square foot first floor would be the police station. And then the second floor, we could either have it as a community center, which may not need the full 5,000 square feet, maybe 2,500 or something along those lines. And we'd have a lovely community center overlooking the fields. The other choice is to contemplate the relocation of borough facilities to the second floor of the police building. Administrative offices and council/court chambers or meeting room certainly fits very well within the 5,000 square foot footprint. This also, you know, this concept, I would like to leave the further debate for another council meeting, but you know, some of the things are considered with COVID and or whatever may come afterwards. It doesn't appear, given the size and construction of our existing council chambers, that this body will be able to meet in public in the borough facility anytime in the near future. And having a new facility where you can meet out in the open and have somewhat of social distancing in a larger room, I think would be greatly advantageous to future administrations. So I would like you all to consider that between now and our next meeting. You know, if we keep the community center, then we'll simply go back and rehabilitate the existing building. Or we could go back to the original plan where we're looking at 623, and that would be to convert the current borough offices library into a borough a library / community center, which has a great deal of added benefit to the downtown. It does take the daily business of the borough administration away from that corner and move it into an interior. It does intensify the use for the neighborhood, so we should be conscious of that as we go forward. That said, let's start with Council President Susan Sorensen for any questions or comments that you may have.
I would actually like to acquiesce to Chris Rodriguez, if Chris, that's okay with you, as the chair of facilities. I know he has a few ideas, so I'd love to hear them.
Go ahead, Chris.
Sure, no problem.
Thank you, Susan. So as everybody knows, well documented earlier in the call, the police department's a priority in my mind ahead of the DPW. I think the DPW's second in my mind, followed by the community center, followed by rehabbing Borough Hall, followed by library, followed by additional ADA in Bicentennial Hall. So those in my mind are the priorities, and that's the list. And that's like a 3-year plan, not a 1-year plan. So as far as the police department's concerned, I prefer a single floor with a basement, eliminates needs for elevators and second floors. I believe that there should be, equal gender-based locker rooms as opposed to what we have today. So that's a thing we don't have, and I know will be part of the plan. I support building on the western side of the parking lot toward Fisk, which the chief had mentioned a little bit earlier. I have walked the site, as I have walked the DPW site as well. I'm thinking this is a 40-year or 50-year building that we're building. I would like to maintain the location and use of the radio tower in its current location, if possible. People are used to it there. Nobody's complaining about it. And if we move it, that causes additional anxiety. And I think we can leave it in place. I do think we can share a parking lot with the community center, which I believe is separate from the police department. It's not on the second floor, but is actually a recreational facility allowable if we convert Rossi property to a recreational use. I believe the facade should be appropriate for the neighborhood. If we do end up deciding to do it on the western side toward Fisk Street, I believe it'll open up parking. We've, as I mentioned, we've walked the site, and we've got a couple of other options as far as parking is concerned as well. By moving the recreation and community center building to where the basketball court, you could see where it's shaded in blue. Because it's a recreational use, it should be allowable based on some information we received from the state. Additionally, the state did not fund the purchase of the Green Acres or Rossi property, so we should have a pretty good case to make that design work. As far as the community center is concerned, I think it would be a single-story, multi-use room with high ceilings, potentially 25-foot ceilings, so that basketball or other recreational sports can happen there, with bathrooms accessible for park users. It would, as I mentioned, be built on the tennis courts or the basketball courts. Again, 40 or 50-year useful life. Basic construction, nothing fancy, potentially a conference room cordoned off for smaller meetings. It could have, could act as a shelter for cooling, but doesn't necessarily need to be earthquake proof, as it's not a disaster recovery site. It could also, in that location, share the generator that was just discussed a bit earlier. And as I mentioned, when we were talking about the DPW, by moving the police department to the location up front, and by having the community center toward the back, it frees up significant parking because it's effectively utilizing the basketball site. We can create two basketball courts where the tennis courts are because we have 5 brand new tennis courts in Fairhaven Fields, and the only thing that I ever see going on the current tennis courts is squirrels and garbage accumulating, and nobody actually plays any tennis there. So we could potentially put additional basketball courts there to repurpose that. So with that, I'll turn it back for
Chris. Hold on for 1 second, Susan, please. Mm-hmm. Just so I understand this. So what you're calling for is really a single level police station of 5,000 square feet, and then also a single level recreation type building to be constructed on land that is now is contained within our ROSI, our registered open space inventory, as a recreation facility. Teresa, by the basic tenets of the ROSI, are we allowed to construct a recreation building, basketball court / community center on ROSI land?
I believe the proper answer to that is a strictly a recreational facility, yes. Anything beyond that, the answer would, I think, be no. I did circulate what they sent from Green Acres a couple of weeks ago to the, I believe, the full governing body, but certainly to the facilities committee. And there's a process we need to go through for that. But they were very clear that it would have to be strictly a recreation facility.
And so by definition, recreation does not mean physical athletic sports, but rather recreational activities, in the term that any event that is managed by the recreation committee.
I'd have to get clarification on that, Councilor.
Chris, thank you for that very thoughtful input.
Thank you.
Susan?
Yes, I agree with Chris. My only thing that I might deviate ever so slightly with Chris is that where the basketball, the blue shaded basketball court, I would actually, if needed, possibly see if we could use that as additional parking, and then have the community, as Chris stated, more have the community center where the tennis courts are, and make it truly a recreational center, maybe even have indoor and outdoor bathrooms so that when there's an event going on, a baseball event or something, that there's facilities that people have can use while they're there at baseball games. Other than that, I think I do agree with the one story with the basement underneath, and with the 5,000 square feet and putting it on the west side.
Got it. All right, let's go down the list. Mike McHugh.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, so Chris laid out, he's done a lot of homework and shared a lot with me, and we've spoken numerous times along with the chief, and of course you as well, Mayor. You know, the news that Teresa shared with us that we would be able to essentially detach the community center from the police station, I think raises a lot of opportunity and creates a lot of potential. And also, I think, Susan, feel free to jump in here, but I think it would be a tremendous benefit for our recreation department too.
Oh my God, yes.
That indoor facility. I know a lot of residents have expressed concerns along those lines. So, you know, Chris, I think, touched on everything of importance. Keeping the radio tower where it is, it'd be very expensive to move. Mm-hmm. Eli, it'd be worth noting that you probably some of those parking spots noted on the east side, there might be some conflict with that, but I think keeping it where it is the best priority. I understand, you know, we would essentially be going, you know, maintenance-wise from moving from one building or one roof, as they call it, to two, but I think separating the community center, especially with all the seniors that attend the community center, having it on the first floor would be hugely beneficial for them. I know, you know, we could get an elevator and stuff like that, but I think overall ease of access and it being a cooling center for seniors and stuff like that, and having it on the first floor would be a huge benefit. So on the police department, along with Chris, I agree that this is the main priority, followed by DPW. I agree 100% with Councilman Rodriguez. Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent. All righty. Let's go Councilperson Chris O'Keefe.
Hi. Thank you, Mayor. My thoughts are that, you know, primarily, I'm glad that we're having this conversation and looking at rebuilding at this current location. I concur with the bulk of what Councilman Rodriguez and McHugh have already stated, and defer with much gratitude for all of his hard work to Chief McGovern, who probably knows most of all what our PD needs, and what will suit the police and law enforcement needs in Fairhaven. So I don't have any further comment, and we'll defer to the comments that have already been made.
Wonderful, thank you. Jim Banahan?
Same, full agreement with all the details that Chris laid out. And yes, ultimately, I suppose, obviously with respect to the PD facility itself, we should all defer to the chief and his knowledge of what the requirements are. And there's nothing lost by taking the tennis court out of there. Councilman Rodriguez is exactly right. We have very nice tennis courts on the south side. There's no reason to feel bad about losing those. And a very good point about keeping the community center on the first floor. We could do all that and build a second floor, but I think the cost is then starting to become a little bit outside of the realm of practicalities. So all in all, full agreement with the details that Councilman Rodriguez laid out.
Wonderful. And Betsy Koch.
Thank you, Mayor. I would have to agree with my fellow council people. I like Councilman Rodriguez's proposal. I especially like keeping the police station to a basement and first floor. While it might be a little more cost effective to put a second floor with council chambers and other offices, I think we would have a problem with parking, that it could become quite crowded with all that activity. I also like having the community center as a separate building with access to the public for bathrooms, both inside and outside of the building. And those tennis courts behind the community center and the police department have really been in bad shape for a long time. So I don't think we're going to miss anything by removing them. So I like the plan. Thank you.
Wonderful. So I'll say this, Councilor Rodriguez, thank you very much for all your efforts. I believe that Eli, Rich, do you have any more questions? Do you understand the design intent as presented by Councilman Rodriguez?
Yes, I do have one very quick comment, very minor. In the state of New Jersey, under the accessibility requirements, any building that's owned by a public agency is required to have elevators between floors. So while it's true that it may be simpler to have an elevator just between the basement and the first floor, you're still going to be required to have an elevator mm-hmm. to serve the basement. That's a code requirement. So, mm-hmm. but that's very minor. Otherwise, I have a clear picture of what's being requested. I think it's fine, and we certainly can proceed on that basis if we're authorized okay. to do so.
Mayor, I'd like to make a suggestion. Before we go too far down the road, I just went back and reread my emails to Green Acres, and under, you know, what you're currently looking at here, putting the community center on the tennis courts and possibly utilizing the blue area basketball court for additional parking, we'd have two moving parts there, two hurdles we'd have to overcome as far as Green Acres goes and the Rossi. So I think it might make the most sense before we get too far down this road to have Eli pencil something out from a concept plan showing what we'd like to do there, and work with Sal and Eli's office and Green Acres to make sure we can get over the hurdles of putting the community center and possibly some additional parking in those locations before we get too far down the road. There is a process, and I think, you know, using professionals, we could get through it. Eli, I'm sure you've done this in the past, am I correct?
Oh, yes, many times.
Yeah, so I think, you know, that might be the, I mean, I'm not trying to slow things down, but, if we can get over that first hurdle and know we're good to go on that, I think that would make the most sense.
Okay.
May I make a comment?
Yes, please.
One of my proposals was simply to use the blue shaded area where the little hand is, if you're seeing the screen right now, just for locating the recreation center. And not even necessarily utilizing the tennis courts. simply by moving it there, you're freeing up all of the space that the current rec center is occupying. And so that actually generates more parking with the movement of the police station to the upper left corner of the lot. And so with even without any parking on Rossi or Green Acres land, we're still generating more parking. And I just wanted to clarify that statement.
Okay.
Either way, Chris, you guys can decide where you want to put the community center building. It doesn't matter. I just want to make sure that we clear the Green Acres hurdle for the building that you have contemplated there before we get too far down the road.
Yep. I agreed. I was just making a point about parking. That was all.
So do we want to say what the preference is of putting the community center building either in the blue basketball area or putting it in the tennis court area?
Look, if we can build a police station without disrupting the current police station, in my opinion, that's the priority. And we have a bit of time to work with Green Acres to come up with a design for the basketball court, whether or not we utilize the tennis court or not. My preference would be to expand the parking to the extent that we can, because we can use the parking dedicated for use with parkland, which we learned over on Willow Street a couple weeks ago.
Yes, so that's true.
It's my desire to try to maximize the parking for rec center use. Every time you go to a rec center, anything right now, it's a parking disaster. And to the extent that we could solve that and be entrepreneurial about other solutions as well, that would be great, whether it includes the tennis court or not.
Teresa, just to Chris's point, could we use the tennis court and work a design where the tennis courts are used as additional parking and bring some more parking back in there?
Any way you design this.
I get that it's on the Rossi. I understand all that process.
I'm just saying.
I know we have to go through that.
You have two moving parts here. One is if you want to use the current Rossi parkland for a recreational facility. And the second is that you want to use for parking that's solely dedicated to the current facilities. So if you want to expand parking, regardless of the location, you still have those two moving parts you have to do.
Absolutely. I did have one random question, and that is, if we did have to go to trailers, where would they go?
Probably on the basketball court.
That's what I thought. Okay, that was it. I'm good.
That's some excellent work, Chris. I can't thank you enough for your thoughts, I'm sure, and Chief. So let's do this. Let's instruct Eli to do kind of a pencil sketch, something just good enough to get us to Rossi to get the initial feedback so we can understand whether we have an actionable application or not. And then we'll move on from there. That's excellent work. About an hour and a half in. So we do have numerous attendees. We have 47 folks. Thank you for staying with us. We have three hands up.
Before you go into that, can I just address a couple of items for the other current facilities for 2021, 2022? Thank you.
Please do so.
Okay. So, as part of thinking through what we're doing with the police department, the DPW, and the community center, I've also given some thought, a significant thought to Borough Hall, Library, and Bicentennial Hall. I view Bicentennial Hall as a smaller project, but I left it as the lowest priority. Borough Hall, my view is that we should keep it as an existing building, potentially retrofit the upstairs usage for Borough Hall offices and a new office floor layout, but as I said, in the same location. It would move the library to the first floor, and I'll get to that in a moment. It would improve the circulation of borough offices, but potentially allow us to put some of the engineering offices at the Borough Hall site. Currently, it would modernize the office with new features like updated windows, updated roof, infrastructure, including heating and cooling, potentially replace the generator if it's at life's end. I'm not sure how old that generator is, but also improve the circulation and layout for the employees so that we optimize the space. Currently, it's not optimized. We have two sets of stairs and an elevator. We probably could get away with something more efficient where a stairwell is not in the middle of the building. As far as the library is concerned, again, keeping it at the same location, it works well for Sickles. It works well for our downtown, and people use it a lot. It's one of the most popular libraries in the county per capita. I would retrofit the entire downstairs of the current Borough Hall location. It's my fifth highest priority. I believe that it would be a project that we would bite off in 2021. I would increase the public space inside the library for book clubs and youth programs. Add additional digital resources and computer locations. Currently, I think we have three computers and not a lot of digital resources. So modernizing the offering and also the collection, including potentially interactive programs and other offerings. And then if we can enhance the natural light, currently the basement is fairly dark and could potentially be improved with some natural light to encourage public use. Lastly, the Bicentennial Hall over on Cedar, I would obviously keep that building. It's historic, but retrofit it for improved digital and audio and use it as a town hall experience, incorporating it more into the flow of our day-to-day. It's the last priority, but I think it could be impactful. If we do make the acoustic improvements, we could use it for council meetings, even maybe board or commission or committee usage. We would have to improve the ADA accessibility. Right now, it is not ADA compliant, though there are ramps. So it is accessible, but those codes change over time. So I would encourage taking a hard look at that and improving it. And then there is a vacant home, which is for sale next to the building. And I would think that it would improve the parking situation and allow for parking over there. So it's something that we consider looking into. And I believe Council President Sorensen has made this suggestion in the past. If we do decide in 2022, it will be too late for the acquisition of that property. But from a Bicentennial Hall perspective, I think we can get a lot out of it. We can incorporate it into our community the way that the old meeting house in Rumson is incorporated into their community and used for meetings by modernizing it and fortifying it and also providing ADA improvements. I think it could be a really nice asset where we can host all of our council meetings with plenty of space, unlike the basement of the current Borough Hall. So with that, those are the major priorities in my mind from the facilities perspective. And as we look at the DPW and we look at the police station and we look at all these other things, holistically, we have property and locations that I think are quite useful. By shuffling the deck a little bit, we can optimize the office space use and also improve the services and meeting locations that we have while adding some much needed parking, which comes up over and over. So with that, that was the, I just wanted to conclude with those other three thoughts before we moved into the public session.
And Chris, I am in lockstep with you.
Okay.
I completely agree.
Thank you very much for your thoughtful and all the hard work you've put in to bring this forward. I greatly appreciate it. So I think, is anybody else in the council like to be heard before we go to the public? Okay, seeing none, let's go into the public comments on the presentation. We have three people use your hands. We ask that you observe a time limit of 3 minutes. And on top of the list is Mr. Chris Hempstead. Good evening, Chris. Unmute.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Excellent. I guess I'm going to be pretty quick for once. I'm sure you're pleased to hear that. I would like to echo, on behalf of the public, that I that I concur with, you know, Councilman Rodriguez on prioritizing the police over the DPW. I guess one question with respect to DPW and the police site, and I guess Borough Hall for that matter, is there any way to consolidate any of the projects into the DPW site by sacrificing the potential sale of what could be three lots in the front of in the north side of DPW, or, you know, four or five lots to the south side of DPW? If we forgave that potential real estate, you know, whatever revenue generation, would there be a way to stick build a new police station over there, or perhaps a Borough Hall, to sort of mitigate some of the intensification across town? I think no matter what, to your point, some people are going to be upset with intensification, but at least it's been acknowledged. So I guess that's my first question. And then the second question, as it sort of relates to that, and I hope that I'm not going to touch a nerve on any executive session stuff, but I noticed that there's a large commercial property in town across from Acme, or next to Acme, for sale. You know, like, is something like that might be 15,000 square feet, could that be considered, or is just too much work would need to go in? Like, would too much work need to go into it for it to even be considered for police and potentially borough facilities? I guess I'll stop there with those sort of two questions. With one being, could you bifurcate some of the use of the DPW site in its entirety and use it as a multi-purpose site? And then the second would be that, you know, that commercial property for sale on Cedar, is that a potential solution?
I'd say that in regards to multi-purpose PD, DPW all in one facility, prior councils examined that fairly extensively and decided against it. That would be a whole nother, concept and another course to go down with this council if they were to inform me that they would like to do so. In regards to 21 Cedar, you know, we had a presentation to purchase 623. You know, the cost with everything involved, you know, approached $20 million. Within the COVID environment, you know, to purchase 21 Cedar probably is not that much money, but certainly within that ballpark. And the reason for the pivot is given the state's finances and what the state may or may not force down to our budget level, we thought it was prudent to really focus on what we had, to maximize what we had, and move forward with that. So, not saying no, Chris, but from what I understand, the owners of that property have received an offer.
Okay.
I don't know where it's gone from there, but you know, I just don't sense an appetite, and any of the council people can chime in, to embark on a project that's going to have, you know, substantial acquisition costs and construction costs.
Yeah, in all fairness, I wouldn't have any idea what that would be. I just was curious because we're looking to do a lot of things, and I think all the ideas are great. And again, to echo your appreciation of the work that everyone put into it, I think it's really thoughtful. I think it's hard to mitigate some of the intensification across all these properties, but I think we're lucky that the police station, the youth center, and the DPW are near each other. So hopefully that's a little bit concentrated. Mm-hmm. One more thing, Mayor, if you will. Around the DPW, is there a landscaping plan to sort of try to do their best to buffer for those neighbors that might sense the intensification of usage, trees, fencing, or a combination of both? I assume there will be, but I didn't really hear about it or see about as part of the plans.
Well, a landscaping buffering plan is a certainty. What form or that may take is yet to be determined. That was certainly it. All right. Thank you very much. Next I have is Rosetta Coleman. Good evening, Rosetta. You're on mute.
Hi, I'm sorry for the confusion.
That's quite right.
My hand is up. It was an accident. I don't have a question.
You don't? All right. Well, thank you for joining us, Rosetta. Appreciate it. Next is Jillian Hoagland.
Hi. All right, good. I'm unmuted. Two questions. First one is, mine is the property that juts out that we guys were talking about earlier. So give or take, how much are you looking to go into the woods? I mean, they're certainly not beautiful woods, but myself and all of my neighbors have grown accustomed to having that as a kind of as a buffer. So it would be a bit jarring, you know, depending how far you broke into the woods. Do you have any direct thoughts on that?
That would be for Rich Gardella to answer, if he could generally.
Yeah, I know it's not up on the screen, but earlier the box that we showed is roughly 60 feet off of that little jut out that you were talking about. Yeah, which is on Allen.
Right, so it's
I'll pull it up. So it's
like 60 feet from where my property ends.
All right, so right here.
Yeah.
See where the hand is right here?
Uh-huh. Yep.
This distance from here to this proposed property line is 60 feet.
Okay.
So this building is about halfway into the recycling center.
Gotcha.
Stands.
And I would just say, I understand why you guys want to make it look really beautiful if it's on Third, but you know, just don't discount the fact that we on Allen and Hendrickson would still like it to be beautiful, you know, and again, anything's better than what's there. I think we all agree, it needs to be overhauled, and we're happy that it's going to be overhauled. But just because maybe you can't see it from Third, I would really truly hope that you would consider making it nice looking. This is still a neighborhood, and you know, we hope that you would take that into consideration. Lastly, some neighbors have told me that in the previous administration, there was this area got a tax break concession, that the taxes around here were about 30% lower because of all the utilities and everything that was going on. Is that something, maybe not 30%, but would you guys consider a tax break concession for the people, you know, immediately impacted by what's going on?
I'll speak to that, Mayor. There's no provision in current tax law for a tax break consideration based just at the discretion of the governing body. Taxes are paid on assessed valuation. If anything, when you see a reduction in taxes in an area that's close to a facility like the DPW, it reflects the value of the homes in that location versus another location. And that's what really would reflect the lower tax. It's a lower assessed value for those areas. That's why they pay lower taxes. But it's not something that the governing body unilaterally makes a decision on.
Is there, is this area taxed, does this area have a lower tax rate?
Everyone pays the same tax rate, Jillian. Mm-hmm. Your tax rate, is nothing more than your total budget divided by, you know, your total assessed valuation, where the rate comes from. Mm-hmm. Then you take your personal assessed valuation and multiply it by the tax rate to come up with what you pay in taxes.
Right.
So if your house is valued at $500,000 and someone else's house is valued at $1 million times the same tax rate, the $1 million home will pay more taxes.
Understood. I guess it was just they were saying the tax rate used to be different, but
no, they're mistaken.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. We have Reverend Thomas Johnson. Reverend? And you're on mute, Reverend. Reverend, there we are.
Have I been able to unmute myself?
There we go. Good evening, Reverend.
Everyone. How are you? Thank you so much. I'm just fine. Thank you so very much, and thank you so kindly for inviting us to the meeting. And we have, as you can see, we have a number of people that have an interest, of course, a vested interest in what goes on and what goes on around our church in Fairhaven. I must say, though, I'm gratified after hearing the meeting this evening to find that it seems our property will not be affected in any manner. And everyone just sort of wanted to know, you know, what was going to happen, how it was going to happen. We had a church meeting, and some of our members went and got the original deed, and as a matter of curiosity, it was our understanding, we found it to be correct, that we could not, of our own, dispense with any of the properties, because when the deed was let, in perpetuity, it was supposed to be for the residents there as a church building. I would have, we were of course going to go to our elder and so forth, but after listening to the meeting this evening, we are gratified that things will remain the same, and we're going to remain at Fisk Chapel in Fairhaven as long as the good Lord allows us. So once again, thank you so kindly for having us.
Thank you very much. You may have
members here that want to have a word, but I, of course, would like to say thank you. And also thank you especially to you, Mayor, because I really appreciate the way you reached out to us and gave us the opportunity to sit down, have a meeting, with my members, a virtual meeting, and work through some difficulties that we were having. So thank you, God bless, and have a very good evening.
Reverend Johnson, as always, you're most welcome. We thank you, you and your congregation, for all that you are and mean to this fine borough. Next up, we have Paul Ferguson.
Probably Carolyn.
Hi, it's Carolyn.
Carolyn, okay. Good evening, Carolyn. How are you?
I'm good. How are you? Thank you all for the great presentation. I definitely like the ideas that everyone agreed on. I just wanted to check on something that I think you intend, but just I just want to make sure it got was clear. So I think the idea is that if parking is added at the community center, that maybe then that parking won't be needed at the DPW.
I believe that is, yes, Councilman Rodriguez's concept. So it won't be required at the DPW. You know, perhaps a little more traffic on Fisk Street, but I think that should be manageable. And because the idea is to take some pressure off a third, I believe. So yes. Councilman Rodriguez, would you like to speak to that more?
Sure. Yeah, the idea, and I spoke to the chief about this, we could do a one block, one way on Fisk toward Maple. And that might alleviate the traffic flow and the any added burden on the community, because it's really tough to get cars down the street two ways on Fisk. And people would come in through Fisk and then exit through either Maple or even on Church. And that would, we've started to think a little bit about the traffic flow. But I, I'm not against additional parking over on 3rd necessarily, if that's what the desire of the council is. But my idea was to try to put parking over by the police station and the rec facility.
Perfect.
Okay. Thank you. Then I was wondering, will that have to impact the site plans that are being done? Like, will they, the DPW site plans include that, or?
The I would think that the police department and rec center parking site plan would take additional parking spots into account. I do think it would actually potentially reduce the usage and burden on the DPW site. That's my opinion. We'll see how the site plan comes out.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to be heard? Raising hands. Seeing none. I want to thank you all for attending tonight's meeting. Councilor Rodriguez, Council President Sorensen, Chris, I want to thank you very much for all the hard work you and Mike McHugh, the members of the Facilities Committee, put through. Obviously, you had a lot of input from Chief McGovern. I believe we now have a good path forward, and call for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So moved.
Everybody have a wonderful evening. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you.